Hi everyone, I'm Justinian Lane of Justinian Associates.
Hi there, I'm Dustin Fox with Justinian Associates.
Hi, I'm Diego Rodriguez with Justinian Associates.
We've got a few things to talk to you about today. There's been a lot of changes going on, as we've talked about before, since President Trump has taken office. One of the subjects that we've spoken a lot about is the DACA program, DACA. Can you tell us a little bit about what that program is?
Yeah, so DACA affords work permits, people to be able to go to school, to certain young people that arrived arrived here in the United States at kind of, if you're 5 or 6 or 7 or things like that, you don't really have any control about coming in. But right now there's some legislation, it looks like, or proposed legislation they're trying to, if that executive order is removed, they feel that they should be another alternate. There should be another option for these people. You know, have you heard a little bit about that, Dustin?
I have. But so what you're saying right now is that Trump is going to remove the executive order, but in order to circumvent, you know, executive orders going back and forth, they're actually trying to introduce a bill to make this law, correct?
So let me clarify. Yeah, it's from what we're noticing, Trump did say that he was going to remove it. They're trying to be proactive on the legislative slide and be able to have some other option available for them. But from what I've been reading, there's kind of news out there that's saying that it might not be a priority for him right now to be able to remove it, which is a great thing. You know, over 700,000 people that Obama helped with.
Yeah, that's right. On Monday, the White House press secretary stated that the president is focusing on people who have a criminal record and are posing a threat to the people and is much less interested in deporting anybody who was brought here as a child. President Trump's kind of waffled on the issue. Nobody really knows what he's going to do. But as of this filming, he has not rescinded the executive order, which a lot of folks thought was going to happen on day one. So we're not really sure where things are going. If it's passed legislatively, though, how would that work? How did the DACA work previously?
So previously, you had to be, you know, vetted. You had good moral character, so they would make sure that you didn't commit those crimes or things like that. Just like what Trump wants to focus against. He wants to focus against people that have, committed major felonies, things like that, and enforce those things. Not people that are just trying to go to school, trying to work, trying to make a better life for themselves. And, you know, now that you've had an opportunity to create a life, because now you have a work permit, you're actually coming out of those shadows. You may have gotten a mortgage, you may have already started school, and now if that's removed, you're going to be kind of in a state of limbo. Mm-hmm. You know, you still haven't committed any crime, you're trying to advance your life, but now the program that allowed you to do those things is no longer going to be there. That's what I feel that the new legislation is going to pass. It's going to be hopefully wonderful.
A recent survey of about 1,300 people with work permits showed that their hourly wages actually was up about 42%. When you have a higher income, I mean, that just is better for the American people, right? Because you're going to have a higher income tax contribution. Yep.
So that translates specifically to higher income tax contributions, which benefits not only them, but all Americans, because that's more money that's coming into the system. That's going to be helping with schools, with roads, the military, all sorts of things. And, you know, through those higher wages, people with work permits through DACA have been able to buy cars, homes, and start new businesses, which increases tax revenue to cities and to states. That's incredible, but, you know, by eliminating this program, you could essentially wipe away, you know, over $430 billion from the U.S. gross domestic process, cumulatively over the next 10 years. It's really, really important, and when you start hearing numbers like that, it really shows how impactful this program is and how well it's been.
Yeah. Right, and one of the things in the stories that I've been reading that I'd never considered is, it seems like many of the people, you know, they came here when they were 2, 3, 4, 5 years old. They've been in the country for 20 years. They're productive, members of the public. They're buying houses and cars, as you mentioned. And I was reading, you know, some of them are planning on, well, I might have to go home to Mexico. I'm gonna abandon my house. I'm gonna abandon my car. You're gonna have foreclosures. Taxpayers are gonna be on the hook for if they bought through any federally guaranteed loans. It's gonna cause a lot of downstream chaos that people really didn't consider, you know, necessarily. And if people have been here for the long periods of time and, you know, they have a job, they have a college degree, they're paying taxes, it doesn't seem like it serves a lot of public good to send people like that home.
No, I don't think so at all. And if you're in that situation right now or know someone that's in that situation, please feel free to contact us at 512-980-0000 or in Espanol, 512-580-5000. There may be some options that are available to you. And, you know, as always, we always offer our consultations free, not only in immigration and personal injury, criminal, family. Any of those questions that you may have, you know, we're here to help. I do find some kind of hope in the situation. There was an article that you know, Trump showed sympathy for Dreamers, saying, you know, we're going to work something out that's going to make people happy and proud. And that makes me, you know, as a Mexican American, you know, hopeful that he's going to see the impact that's going on there. You know, there's been surveys and things like that from mayors and support all the way across the board that this is a good program. So I'm glad that he's hopefully will not prioritize this program over, you know, getting people that should be deported, criminals and things like that, that violate our laws.
Well, he certainly considers himself a businessman, so maybe he's actually able to see what impact it would have down the road.
Yeah.
Absolutely, and you know, you mentioned there's been a lot of support from mayors. I think 16 or 20 or something like that. Mayors have just sent a letter to the president asking him to consider. They might run into some problems with that. The mayors who are running what they call the sanctuary cities. Can you explain what a sanctuary city is, Diego?
So sanctuary city essentially is not going to cooperate solely with ICE instructions. So what that means is if you are pulled over and you had a outstanding speeding ticket. And you had an order or a warrant or things like that, they're going to take you to jail. Typically what would happen is they would, again, notify federal authorities, which is ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement. And from there, they would put a hold to be able to investigate, figure out what's going on now. Austin and many other cities are actually starting to say, you know, we're not going to go ahead and cooperate with those things. We're going to not just be at the beck and call of ICE enforcement. I think Governor Abbott actually is threatening some type of financial...
Right. He's threatening to withhold funding to sanctuary cities. So Austin and you know, virtually every city receives some sort of funding from the state, and the state in turn also receives funding from the federal government. So there's two revenue streams that a city that's being a sanctuary city could see cut off. They could see their federal money get cut off, or their state money, or perhaps even both. Certainly the political leanings of Greg Abbott, I would believe he would follow through with the threat, if he can, to withhold money and funding from any sanctuary cities. And then that puts the cities in a bind. Do they do what they think is right for the city, or do they, you know, with the population that is you know, here, the Dreamers, the DACA people, etc., or do they, you know, try to follow the policies that they disagree with? So it's going to set up a really unfortunate showdown if this happens. I'm hopeful that I saw that there's bipartisan support for the bill to take that executive order that created the DACA program and make that actual federal law, and then that would be very helpful, I think.
You know, it's that program that kind of goes in and you say, you know, it's the state, the governor, you know, they're going in the Capitol trying to make a city do what they want. It's a political play. It's, you know, it's coarse. It's very similar, like when the federal government withholds state funding. You know, there's been situations where, you know, if you don't switch the drinking age to XYZ, we're going to withhold state highway funds. And it's just a political, you know, kind of political move. Yeah.
And I'll tell you, it's pure cynical politics. And the thing that really, to be honest, it just pisses me off about this is, people like Governor Abbott and a lot of other politicians, they talk about they want states' rights. They want to be able to set their own policy. They don't want the federal government making them do things. So here we have Governor Abbott saying, Austin, you're going to follow the federal government's rules or we're going to punish you. Well, I guarantee you, if the federal government had passed some sort of a gun control bill that Governor Abbott disagreed with, he certainly wouldn't be threatening to withhold funding from cities that weren't following the law. Instead, he'd be saying, oh no, I encourage the resistance and this is Texas and we're going to do what we want. And you can't make us follow the federal law. So all I'm looking for is some sort of consistency. Is it the states have the rights, or is it the federal government has the rights? It's unquestioned right now, and actually forever, that immigration is a matter of federal policy. Is that right, Diego?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. The states have no power to decide who can come to this country, who can stay in this country. It's a federal issue, because in any other way just would not be feasible at all to let you know, Arizona decide this can be who is a citizen, and Texas decide this who could be a citizen. It's not feasible. And I think Dustin had some other issues with feasibility of these policies.
Yeah, I mean, just thinking about the feasibility of the entire idea itself of deporting these folks. I mean, the federal officers don't have enough, you know, staff to simply just round them all up and then get them out of the country, even if they really wanted to.
I mean, yeah, and that's not even touching on the amount of, you know, abuse that would probably occur with something that's on that level. But I agree with you on the feasibility. It'd be very difficult, the amount of officers and what type of undertaking that would take to, you know, really move all undocumented people out of this country or deportations. And, you know, that is at the most extreme level of what's going to happen. I think that our immigration system, it's not perfect, but there are options available, and there's definitely programs which I think are great, like the U visa, things like that, that do give options to people that are here undocumented or family-based situations. So.
Yep, and you know, this whole part of it will be a conflict between state and federal law. And Dustin has something to talk about that can be kind of interesting. What happens if one state's laws conflict with another state's laws? In this case, it would be, I think, Colorado and Texas. What do we have?
Yeah, I mean, this is going to be something that's going to be real prevalent in the news going forward, as you guys will imagine. Here in Texas, there was a school teacher. In 2015, she tested positive for marijuana use. And the state board for the educator certification sought to suspend her. Basically what happened is she went to Colorado over Christmas break, and she apparently had a pot brownie, came back, and later tested positive. So what happened here is the judge actually agreed with her as saying that, you know what, Colorado's laws are different than Texas. She went there and did something that was perfectly legal, came back here, and I mean, she may have had it in her system, but when she was there, she did something perfectly legal, although it was illegal here. And what was the analogy that they used in that case?
The analogy was that, like, gambling is illegal in Texas, but you can't be punished if you go to Las Vegas and gamble for a whole weekend. You can do whatever you want if it's legal in that state. So I think it's an interesting analogy.
Yeah, I mean, this is something that you're going to see a lot of going forward, because I believe there's 20 or 25 different states where at least marijuana has been decriminalized, not illegalized. Yeah, that's correct.
Right. It'll be interesting to see how it plays out and what kind of policies will come into play with what one state will allow and what the other state won't allow. In this case, the proceeding was before an administrative law judge, if I recall.
Yeah, that's correct. Right. So they can go back to the district court if on appeal.
Right. A lot of agencies have what's called an administrative court, and they'll have an administrative law judge. That's how a lot of agencies get decisions made. And then if they disagree with that decision, then it goes to an actual court, in this case, a district court. And then that's how actual law would get made. I'm curious if this is going to get pursued. If so, I would imagine there'd be a lot of briefs from organizations that have pretty strong opinions on, first of all, whether or not student or teachers should be punished for using marijuana, period. And second of all, then, if organizations have the authority to punish individuals for activities that they commit that are legal where they commit
sure.
them.
I mean, as an analogy, what this case brought to light also was, you know, the state board for like licensing agencies actually have a lot of power. There was this one where they actually revoked a license for a teacher who had a relationship with a student who was a high school student, but happened to be 18 years old, attended a different school district and a different school, and they met at a non-related school function, and they upheld that. The third court of appeals found that they had within their right to revoke her license.
Yeah, and regardless of how you feel about that, it still shows that this would be otherwise be a perfectly legal. You have two people who are consenting adults, don't work together, no position of power or coercion, and they're not able to have a relationship with each other. That shows the power that the licensing board would have. And, you know, from time to time, they can overstep their bounds. If you don't think it was maybe in this case, certainly in other cases, agencies will assert their authority. And it's kind of it's much more wide-ranging than people would think, that it's not just the court system. You have all these agencies with their administrative courts, and it takes time and money to fight those battles
yeah,
as well.
I mean, it's a slippery slope, too. Where do you draw the line of what they can and cannot do?
Yeah. You know, on a different context, you can also have situations, say you've had a couple drinks and you get a DWI. You're going to be dealing with that, you know, like everyone will know, criminally, you know, in the criminal courts. But to keep your license or do those things, you actually have to go to an ALR hearing, and that's an administrative hearing that will actually see. We have to present why you should keep your license. There's steps you need to take there, but it just shows there's very different things and different, you know, situations can cause and create different problems. And this is an example of where you, as a regular person, could find yourself in an administrative hearing, not just a teacher or an attorney or someone that's in those organizations.
Right, and as Diego says, there's two different issues. I mean, if you do get pulled over, you've had a couple of drinks, first of all, you don't want to go to jail or get a criminal conviction. But if you're like anybody else, you probably also want to keep your driver's license. So, I mean, we handle both sides of that equation with the criminal side of things and the administrative portion of things. We heavily discourage anybody from drinking and driving. It's a terrible thing, and you should never do it. Yeah. People do sometimes make mistakes, and if that does happen, we are able to step in and advise you what your rights are. Yeah. Do we charge for those consultations?
No, we absolutely do not charge for those consultations. One of the things that I like to you know, tell my clients, it's not against the law to have a drink and drive. It's against the law to have a drink and be above 0.008. So if you've had one and dinner, and they pull you over, maybe there was something else that could have happened when whatever may have been, you have to look at those circumstances. You know, it's, there's a leeway there because different people have different tolerances, things like that. I'm a big guy. I'm 6'6", 285. Working on the 285, get it lower, but I can have two beers and it wouldn't necessarily affect me like someone else having two beers, you know, being a little bit,
yeah, being 5 foot.
Yeah, exactly. But if you find and you encounter yourself in a situation that's like that, come and speak to us. We'll walk you through the process. We'll walk you through what's going on there. But let's look at your case. Let's evaluate it. Let's take the time and, you know, really make sure to bring clarity into this kind of scary situation that's going on there.
And that would include, you know, possession of marijuana, you know, just on the topic itself,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Right, and there's of course also rules with driving while you're under the influence of marijuana or any other drug, which is something we very strongly discourage.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't have any moral judgments. If you're somebody who wants to go use marijuana, we're not going to say you're a bad person or a good person. It's that's your decision.
Yeah.
If you're getting into trouble doing so, we can help with that. And we're certainly going to keep an eye on the developments. I know there's a big push for medical marijuana to become a thing here in Texas, and there'd be rules surrounding that. If and when that happens, we'd be available to consult on if you run into any problems with that. And the same with people, you know, most people I think who understand if they come from a state where marijuana is legal or they have a medical marijuana card in another state, they understand that you can't bring it into Texas. And that's just, again, the interplay of Texas says this is legal across the border in another state, it's illegal or vice versa. You have to respect the law enforcement authorities in the state that you're in. So if you've got any questions about what the policies are regarding drugs in Texas, I tell you to call us for free consultation, but we can tell you if it's a drug, it's not legal here. So just don't bring it in Texas. If you live in California or Washington or one of the other states that's okay with marijuana, have it over there. Do not bring it over here. We really don't want to have to help you on that kind of a matter. We can if you do get arrested for some sort of a possession charge. We help people out with that fairly regularly, I think.
Yeah, of course we do. If you find yourself in a situation where maybe you have something that you shouldn't and you encounter a police officer, and you know, you also have to look to see, you know what, yeah, it did occur. There was something that was in my pocket or whatever it may be. But was the stop legal? Was there reasonable suspicion? You know, was there a reason for him to be able to search you? Was there a reason for that to be able to become discoverable? That's where you start looking at things of, as a criminal attorney, you start looking at the situation of, was it, you know, constitutional to be able to stop that? Did they violate any laws? Is there anything that we can look at?
We can do a whole video on the Fourth Amendment.
Yeah.
And we may do that. We get a lot of questions about it. And Diego was talking about, you know, was the stop legal? Did the police officer have probable cause to stop you? And that matters because let's just say that the police officer decides, you know what, I don't like people who drive red cars. That guy has a red car, so I'm going to search him. Whatever he finds in that search, a judge should say is not admissible. So if he finds a joint, a pound of marijuana, three dead bodies, whatever it is, that should not be admissible. And it's an old legal doctrine that they call the fruit of the poisonous tree, that they don't want to reward police officers for bad conduct, for breaking the law. And that's one of the things, if you talk to experienced attorneys, if you come to us, we will look through every aspect of the case to see if every element, every part of your stop and your arrest was permissible. And if it wasn't, sometimes then the entire thing will go away. Because, you know, to use the example that I had, if the you being pulled over wasn't a permissible stop, then it doesn't matter if they found drugs in the car. The court would rule you can't introduce those drugs as evidence, which means there's no more charges. So one of the reasons that we have started doing criminal law is a lot of our immigration clients come to us because of they have a minor run-in with the law.
Yeah.
If somebody does get arrested because they have, you know, they have a joint or they had a couple of drinks, can we still help them?
Yeah, of course we can. We'll look at the situation. We're not the attorney or we're not the type of firm that's just going to go plea you out. We're going to look at every single option you have, just like Justinian was saying. We're going to look at the beginning, from the stop all the way to the end. Was the case handled right? Was the evidence handled right? I mean, we have to look at all those things. And if we're not happy with kind of what's moving forward, we're going to try to get your case dismissed. If not, we're going to take it to trial. Obviously, we inform you about those decisions. We inform you about the options. Not only the options, what risks you can take by taking these things to trial. But it's all the way across the board, be it criminal law, immigration, personal injury, we don't take the easy way out. We're not your attorneys that's just going to come in and do one step. We're going to look at every option you have, and we're going to work hard as a team with you, as your legal representatives, to help put you in the best situation, be it bring you back into status, help remedy some harm that occurred to you through the financial aspect of it being a personal injury, making sure you're out of trouble and out of jail when it comes to criminal. You know,
speaking of being in jail, let's say when someone finds themselves in jail, can you get them out of jail?
Yeah, get them bonded out, figure out another solution there, both criminal and immigration. I get calls all the time, and I'll go to jail at 10 o'clock. You know, I think this week I'm going to be all over Texas visiting people in jails and even in Louisiana. It's really important because when you're in detention or when you're in custody, it's not like the day outside. Every hour counts. And I want you to know that when you call us, you're going to speak with me directly. I'm going to start putting you and making you a priority to be able to put us in a position to get you released as fast as possible. It's not, oh, here's an hour. Well, let's wait till Monday. Or you know what? It's 9 o'clock. It's Diego, get up. There's someone that needs your help and they're asking you. It's your family that's coming to me and saying, please help. My son, my daughter, my brother, my husband, my friend, whatever that relationship may be. Understand that I take that relationship that we're creating together very, very important. And I know how much trust you're putting in me. Now you can go and tell them, hey, we have people working for you on the outside. We're going to make sure that we get you released, both immigration and criminal. So
you absolutely will have a team working for you. I did a lot of work for a law firm years ago that did criminal defense work and court-appointed criminal work. And I had to visit people in jail many times. And Diego's right. It's not a pleasant place to be. I was uncomfortable just being in there for a few hours. I my heart goes out to the people that are, you know, in there for a long period of time for, you know, minor offenses, ones who can't get bail or things like that. It's not a fun place to be. And, you know, Diego kind of undersold it. He's taking one of the company cars and he's going on a, I don't even know how many 100-mile road trip around to Texas and even down into Louisiana. Because for Louisiana, immigration, again, is a federal matter, so we can help people in all 50 states. It doesn't matter. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely not. When it comes to the federal thing, right now we have clients all over the country, all over the world that are outside that we're trying to bring in. We're here to help. Just because we're from Texas, it doesn't mean it's just local. Yeah.
Right. And, you know, you might see some ads on TV for other firms. I don't think a lot of the guys that you see on TV are literally going to go get themselves into a car and drive for 6 hours to go get somebody out of jail.
Yeah, they're going to hire someone.
Yeah. Diego will do it. I'll do it. Dustin will do it. Yeah. We're the ones that are actually going to be working your cases. So that's something you might want to consider if when you're looking to hire a law firm. Is the guy or the girl on TV, is that really the person that's going to work your case? Or are they just, I don't know, sitting back counting the money and enjoying the fruits of everyone else's labor?
I've actually had someone be very shocked when I went to go sign up a client. It was an hour and a half away. I was like, oh, I didn't think that you would be the attorney showing up here at my door. So, yeah, it's a nice personal service.
Of course. When we start your case, we don't pass it along. We're not a mill. We're the type of attorneys, like we said, we start your case, we're going to finish your case, and we're going to be in direct contact with you all along the way. That's the most important thing, like Justinian was saying.
Right. You'll get you'll know your attorney's email address. It's really simple. Whatever our first name is, @justinian.com. Send us an email. We'll get it directly. We don't have a filtering system where it goes to the receptionist and then over here and there. You'll get a hold of us directly. We all talk to clients anytime, day and night. I represent a lot of clients from around the country for people who took drugs that caused them troubles. And, you know, I'll take a phone call at 10 o'clock on a Saturday if that's the time that works best for the clients. We have this kind of a firm because I've worked in environments and I know of environments where the clients never get to talk to their lawyer. When they send somebody out to your house, it's not an attorney. It's a guy who's on a commission who's going to get paid $50 if you sign a contract and he can't answer your legal questions. We don't want to run that kind of a shop. We want to be the law firm that if you have any legal question whatsoever, you know you can come to us. We answer questions all the time. I've spent over the past 2 days probably an hour emailing back and forth with an individual who lives in another state that a product injured him, and because of a Supreme Court ruling, we can't help him. I've explained to him about how that ruling works. I've asked him, I answered a lot of his questions. I've told him what some other avenues of recourse are. That's me doing it personally. We're not getting paid for it. We're here to help. And that's the thing about us that I think is probably what I'm most proud of that differentiates us from some of the other places, is we're all good people who are here to help. I mean, Diego, you help people all day long.
Yeah, I meet with clients. Sometimes I'll meet with clients all day, and then it'll be 6 o'clock, and I'll start doing work. You know? But one of the interesting things about technology is this bridge. You know, you're watching this on social media or whatever avenue you're you're watching a YouTube or whatever, wherever you found us. We do video conferences all the time. And if you're like, oh, but I'm in Dallas or I'm in another part of the country, we set you up. We have a nice little setup. You'll speak with me directly when it comes to video conference. It kind of breaks that bridge. That technology allows us to be able to now meet in person. We have, if you need me to explain something that's a little complex, we have our whiteboards there. I go through everything step by step. And that consultation, that personal attention, it's free. You know, Justinian, as the owner of the firm, allows us to be able to always offer those free consultations, to be able to give you that quality legal advice, to give you, you know, and take that time where, I think he's mentioned in some videos previous, you have to norm, in some other firms, you have to have the attorney working every single hour, making money. And he allows us to be like, no, you can go and meet with people and give them those consultations, give them that advice. Even if we can't help them, we're gonna make sure that they're not taken advantage of in other situations.
Yeah, I was just about to bring up the fact that, you know, that guy who found us on the internet, called me up. I was like, all right, well, it sounds like you need immigration services. Yeah. I text Diego, hey, are you free? We conference called them in, and we set up a schedule for the next day where they were actually able to just Skype the whole meeting. And from what I heard, we were able to help that individual.
Yeah, we're 100% able to help them.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, they're out of Odessa. It was, you know, I took about an hour time. Even if they would have decided, you know what, we're not ready to pursue that right now. What they got was valuable information. They got answers to their questions. It didn't cost them anything, and they did speak to one of us directly. You know, be it in whatever field we're at. When we say we do this, I challenge you to give us a call. Put us to the test. If you're saying, these guys are just gonna push us off to other things, I challenge you, let us help. Let us see what we can do for you. And we have all the options for you, over the phone, email, commenting, in person at one of our offices, or like if you're have a family member in custody, I will go out and visit them. I'm gonna go take those times. So once again, I challenge you. If you got an issue or if there's anything that we can have, let's see how we can help you. And it's free.
And if we're not, you know, meeting that commitment, you've got my email address. Email me and let me know. If you're getting pushed off, if you don't think you're getting the service that you think you should, I definitely want to know about it. I'm very accessible. Dustin is very accessible. Diego is. We do our best to help people, and our best usually surprises people. I don't think we've let anybody down. And I know, Dustin, I mean, you spend a lot of time giving free consultations as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
even on issues that, like, we don't handle, you'll answer questions.
Yes, yes. I mean, I've answered questions regarding real estate HOA problems. I mean, that's not something I particularly, you know, handle often. I primarily do motor vehicle accidents, motorcycle accidents. But, you know, I took the time to answer what I did. And if I didn't understand, you know, the entire legal problem itself, I just referred it out to someone that I know and trust. And, you know, we network all the time. So we know basically every single type of area in the law. Or if we can't do it, we'll point you in the right direction.
Our firm has chosen a limited number of practice areas that we think we're very good in. If you've been pulled over because you have 2,000 pounds of marijuana in the back of your car, we're not the firm for you. If you've got a capital murder charge, that's not a case that we can handle. What we can do, though, is we will find the attorney for you that will do a great job with that. And we work with other firms all the time. Is that right?
Yeah, of course. There's situations that, in my arena, you know, immigration, that kind of blends itself over to labor law. You know, we don't deal with maybe overtime violations, people that were working. Say you're a server or a waiter, and you get paid $2.15 an hour. We know that you get tipped and you actually don't make $2.15 an hour. But after 40 hours, you do not get time and a half on $2.15 an hour or whatever your wage is. You have to get paid at the minimum wage. A lot of people don't know that, and that really does affect a large number of people. So me personally, that's not in my wheelhouse. What we do is we'll partner with another firm and let them know, hey, this is what's going on with their case. We're gonna help and manage whatever situations you have there, work with them, but we wanna bring you with the best experienced people, be it with us or with someone else. Your priority, your situation, your problem is very, very important to us. And if it's not with us, we're gonna send you over with someone that we trust, that we refer, we know they do good work.
Well, I mean, we don't simply just Google and then send you to the
next
attorney.
No, of course not. Or just refer you to the state bar.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's a lot of folks that call us to try to get representation from us. They're like, yeah, you're my fourth attorney I called. Every single one of them just says, hey, call the state bar. And that's not something that we do. I spend a lot of time researching attorneys to send you. Like, for example, someone called in and said, hey, I really need a tax attorney. We don't do taxes.
Nope.
But what I primarily focus on are motor vehicle accidents, motorcycle accidents, bicycle accidents. You know, and I was just looking in the news recently. There was someone in Georgetown. It was, unfortunately, it was hit by a hit and run and killed. And that's really unfortunate because you see a lot of bicycle accidents in the news, you know, just all the time, especially during high bicycle season. And, you know, I think that's prompted JC and our marketing team to try to put something special together, right?
Right. One of the gentlemen who works for us, our accountant for the firm, is very active in the cycling community. He actually lives in Georgetown. He'll sometimes ride to our Pflugerville office. He rides his bike extensively, and we're working with him to put together a really good bicycle safety video. Here's what you do to keep yourself safe, and then we're going to take it to the next step, and we're going to talk about if this happens, these are what your legal rights are. If this happens, these are what your legal rights are, how a law firm can help if, God forbid, you do have some kind of an accident, that we're hoping will be a really good resource for the cycling community. If you've got some legal questions that you'd like to know, please contact us and let us know. I know one of the questions that was brought up is, what happens if you're riding your bicycle and somebody's dog comes and causes you to take a tumble? We're going to address that particular issue. Or if somebody's child, you know, throws a ball at you and you tip your bike over, or of course, you know, the more common ones, if you get hit by a car or a bus or something along those lines, we'll address that and talk about what we can do to help, but more importantly, how to prevent those sorts of things from happening. We love helping injured people, but we'd love it even more if we didn't have any injured people to help. We'll do our part to help prevent accidents and keep the community safer. And if there's any issues that you think that our attention could be directed to help reduce those kinds of accidents, please let us know. Preventable accidents, we want to prevent them if it's possible.
Yeah, it's one of those things about information. The information is not only for the adult cyclist, but also think about that information at the angle of, you know, you have teenagers, you have children, or things like that, and they may not be aware of what things you should do. This little video will inform you on what you should tell your kids. Be like, hey, this is what you should be doing, this is what you should be avoiding. You know, obviously cross at, you know, designated areas, things like that. As adults, you've lived a little bit of life. You have a little bit more common sense than, say, a 12-year-old or a 14-year-old. That's where the value of this video comes, because you can really have, now as a parent, say, hey, I know you don't want to think about this, you're riding your Huffy or whatever it is that you're doing, but please be aware of these steps that you can take to kind of be preventatory. And, you know, it's a great resource because it works on both sides. But like he says, you want to prevent injuries, be it as adult cyclists or when you're dealing with your children, your high school age kids. Yeah.
Right. I mean, bicycling, a lot of people really enjoy it, and we want them to have as best a time as they can on the roads and not be injured. And if they are injured, to know what their rights are and what the recourse is and who can be held responsible for those sorts of injuries. It's something we really believe in, is giving back and sharing the knowledge that we have. You know, we all went to law school. We learned a lot of stuff. We want to put that into a place where everybody can understand and learn what their rights are, because if you don't know what they are, it doesn't really do you any good. So we've made a big investment into a studio and video presentations. You're going to see those, of course, every week. We're building a video law library. If you've got questions, give us a call, send us an email. Dustin might talk to you on the phone for 20 minutes and research the question and send you the answer, or maybe I put it into a video. It all depends. But if there's one thing we really want you to get to understand about our firm, is that we're here to help people. We're not like the stereotypes that they have of lawyers. We really are good people, and I hope that comes through with this. And if it doesn't, why don't you come down to one of our offices? We've got three great locations. In Pflugerville, we have a location at 305 Heatherwild, Suite 200 out in Pflugerville. Our Austin office is at 8770 Research Boulevard. We're very proud of that facility. It's a former two-story bank building. We've got a really cool vault. We don't even know how heavy the door is. We think it's around 6,000 pounds. We keep trying to figure it out, but it's fun to play with. Yeah. We've turned it into a law library. You can come on in there and sit down and chat with us. And we've got a really big news coming soon to announce about a new building we're getting into in San Antonio. I'll give you a teaser. It's huge. We're very excited to be moving into San Antonio. We've had a lot of demand there, and we're going to be helping a lot of people there too. If we're not near you though, Diego, me, Dustin, somebody will get in the car. We'll drive to you. We'll help you out. That's what we do.
Yeah, thanks again, guys, for watching, you know, joining us this week. Like I said before, and said, you know, every single week, we challenge you to please put us to the test. If you have questions, or if you have any friends or family that have questions, please let us know. We're happy to answer. We're happy to help the community. We're here to help people in different areas of law. Once again, thank you so much for tuning in. My name is Diego Rodriguez with Justinian Associates.
I'm Justinian of Justinian Associates.
I'm Dustin Fox from Justinian Associates. Thanks for tuning in.
We'll see you next time.
Have a great day.